What's a day in the life of Grant King like? Well, give us an idea of...
Oh, you know, pretty relaxed.
Go to woe, pretty relaxed. Does he look relaxed?
Look, there's not a standard answer to that question.
No, it varies so much, doesn't it?
I think over time, people in my positions probably develop certain attributes, but one of them is an inability to concentrate on anything for more than about 10 or 15 minutes. For no other reason, that there's a lot that comes across the desk every day or wherever you are. You know, often one's travelling to talk to people in the business, travelling to talk to shareholders, travelling to talk to people, partners, you know, customers, and of course employees as well. The content varies all the time, the issues vary all the time, but at the end of the day, people ought to be making a difference. I should be making a difference, so we should be doing the things that cause something to happen.
How do you have quality decision-making in an environment like that where there are constant interruptions and so many different demands on you and your brain?
Well, there's an answer to that question that answers many questions, and it is in two parts. One, I think the more knowledge and experience one has of one's business helps because there's a context to everything. And I know there'll be all sorts of different views in the world, but my view is that a deep knowledge of your business and your industry helps in making those decisions and choices. But the other answer, which is the more general answer and answers many questions you might ask, is what informs you when you make those decisions and choices? And in our company, we talk about our principles and values. We've spent some time thinking about them and codifying them. And I find that the difficult decisions and the difficult choices we make nearly always require us to think through what they are and how that would influence that decision or choice we would make. And at the end of the day, it becomes second nature. I don't sit down there with a checklist and go through it, but I often reflect on the many issues we consider and the many puzzles we try to solve, and I know that embodied in the solution is a very clear sense of what's right, not just in an ethical sense, but in a sense of our business. We articulate a set of five principles. We say they're hierarchical, which is unusual, but they are in an order for a reason. The first of those is a duty of care. There's no task worth doing, for example, if it can't be done safely. So it's a gate through which all other activity passes. And that duty of care, I hope, transcends every decision that we make. But second only to that is the requirement to create value. So we're a value-creating organisation. That's the type of organisation we are.
For shareholders.
We are a value-creating organisation. That value is distributed in part to shareholders through profits. Profits is a distributional activity. It's not a purpose. Our purpose is to create value. Mm-hmm. We then distribute that value to our shareholders, our employees, communities. We even pay taxes to governments. We talk about two other principles. One is diversity and the other is transparency. And diversity in the broadest sense of the word, if you're a student of successful organisations or even cultures, it seems to me that diversity lies at the core of them. Diversity nearly always at the core of long-term survival. You know, the other principle which we talk about a lot and which I find is most often transgressed in business and people's personal lives is one of transparency. Nothing remains secret forever. So you talked before about technology. Well, one of the things that technology's done is accelerate the rate at which all things become known. That's what it does. So it forever staggers me why people make decisions based on the premise that don't worry, no one will ever know, but so many decisions are. So if you subject yourself to those principles, then more often than not, the right decision comes out the other end.
So what was the thing you learnt most after university that you wished you'd learned at university?
Well, so the thing that I most reflect on what is taught differently in universities from what you need in a business life is to write briefly and not at great length. So at university, you're rewarded for length, writing more rather than less. And I very quickly learned in business, writing less rather than more was important. And there's a huge difference between the two. It's very difficult to write less than it is to write more.
If I can get you to step back and think about your leadership style and what that is and how that shows up, how would you describe that?
Yeah, at the end of the day, and I'm not sure I'd weight these words or put them in any order, but I'd like to think that I'm thoughtful about whatever the circumstance is that we're dealing with. I think I can be quite challenging in terms of the arguments and ideas that people put forward, but I'd like to think that always happens in an environment of great respect for others. And I believe very strongly in respect as a principle. A duty of care is our first principle. Care is a value we talk about in Origin. So I think that, that respect sits at the core of all relationships. Mm. Yeah, I guess a degree of energy is also important. Yeah, when I say energy, I mean at the end of the day, one's got to be enthusiastic about what one does. So hopefully people would say I was also enthusiastic, but I still think others should judge that.
That question, I look at my electricity bill and I just go, well, how come it's gone up so much if it's not the carbon tax and, if it's not an issue about demand and so forth? So
you'd like
I've got you here. Can we have an answer, please?
So, as with all questions...
I've read a lot lately about over-investment.
All questions have an answer. There's a reason and there's a cause. What's caused that to occur, right? So the reason is that the network component of your energy bill, which is about 50%, has gone up very substantially. And added to that has been a number of charges which you'd broadly label green charges, RET charges, carbon charges, and other state-based schemes. And that's what's driving the increase in your bill. So that's the reason it's gone up, assuming your consumption is constant. Yeah. Most of our industry was owned by governments and operated by governments for many, many, many years. It's only a phenomenon of the last 10 years that these industries have been partially deregulated, substantially deregulated in some areas and privatised. And that large increase in network charges is because, I think in greater part, there was substantial underinvestment in prior years because the price-setting process was ultimately determined by politicians. Mm. And one of the benefits of privatising is that the private sector is much more likely to price on some long-term sustainable basis. But that's not the same basis that politicians often use to price things to the community. And the price outcomes we're seeing in some of our businesses are because where those price controls still exist, people are taking the short-term answer rather than long-term answer. Let's keep the price down today and let someone else worry about tomorrow. So you're paying for bad decisions that someone made 10 years ago, 5 years ago, to underprice the provision of a certain part of the service that comes to you.
How much longer do you think you could generate the energy and the enthusiasm and before
so,
you
so
saw
because
time
I,
to hand over to
Because
somebody.
I value the precision of language, I plan to be around for a very, very long time yet. How long I intend to work is a different question. So that's a different question. So. I'm fortunate enough to say that at the end of the day, it's not the economic reward that drives me. I enjoy what I'm doing, and whilst ever that's the case and I have the energy, I'll keep doing it. But that's also subject to the interest of our own board as well. So either they or I will make a decision at some point in time, but it's not tomorrow.
Okay. That's, you heard it here first. ladies and gentlemen, would you please put your hands together and thank Frank King.